Hey, what's up, y'all? Welcome to my analysis of Book 2 in the Here to the Empire trilogy, aka the Thrawn trilogy. And today we're going to talk about Dark Force Rising. Now, right off the bat, I just want to say that this book is not as good as the first book in this cycle, which was Here to the Empire. However, it's still a good book. It's still highly recommended by me. But there are some things that drag the story down, and I'm going to primarily focus on the Talon Card subplot and also the MacGuffin plot, where our heroes are trying to obtain the coordinates to the secret Katana fleet, aka the Dark Force Rising fleet. It's a fleet of dreadnoughts, and we're going to talk about that in my analysis. And I think those two things, Talon Card subplot and the MacGuffin, are two things that really dragged the story down and kind of robbed it from being a perfect book, in my opinion. The Talon Card subplot, frankly, is just boring for me. It's not as exciting as in the first book. I really enjoyed Talon Card's subplot in the first book. It was exciting, and I thought it was a great character, and it was nice to see a band of smugglers and thieves in the subplot integrated into the higher, the bigger picture of the Star Wars saga. Now, in regards to the MacGuffin, there's a character in this book that supposedly has the coordinates to the secret Katana fleet. Or not that he has them, but he knows of them. He has the knowledge. And our heroes at some point in this story are after this person, and eventually this person is found, but we never have a scene with him. There's not a single scene with this person. This person is talked about second-handedly. They're talked about, you know, off-screen. So that was really just very peculiar for me, and I don't know why Timothy Zahn chose to do that. I felt like if you're gonna have a MacGuffin that's a person and not have a scene with them or not have any dialogue with them, why not just make it like a secret data card or something with the coordinates? Now, a good example of a story that did do that good, where the person was the MacGuffin, is Days of the Future Past in the X-Men series. Mystique was the MacGuffin. Everyone's trying to get Mystique. Everyone's trying to stop her, get to her, and all that. So I kind of have no idea why Timothy Zahn chose to approach that certain subplot in that way. Now, in regards to what I loved about this book, number one, I loved Princess Leia's story arc in this book. She truly comes, she truly matures into that Jedi potential Skywalker kind of figure. And I was really moved by some of the scenes in this book in regards to her. I also loved all the scenes between Jorah Seeboth and Luke Skywalker. Mara Jade was exciting. The introduction of Dreadnoughts was really cool. So, enough of this little intro. Let's get to it and let's analyze this book and review it. So, our story begins right after Here to the Empire, the previous book in this three-book cycle. And we are at the planet Meeker, and Thrawn is about to raid Talon Card's base, and Talon Card is trying to escape because he's in deep shit, because it is known now to Grand Admiral Thrawn that he had a hand in Luke Skywalker's escape, which he was trying to keep a secret. But now the cat is out the bag, and Admiral Thrawn wants Talon. So Talon hides behind an asteroid, and Thrawn gets this hunch to attack the asteroid. It's like his intuitive nature as a Grand Admiral can sense that there's something hiding behind that asteroid. But before Thrawn's attack is successful, Mara escapes. But before Admiral Thrawn's attack is successful, Mara Jade, who is Talon Card's partner, senses danger and they escape. Now, Mara Jade is a Jedi-like character. She's not a full-fledged Jedi, but she is Force-sensitive. And she used to be the Emperor's hand. And basically, the Emperor's secret assassin. And there's still remnants of the Emperor's directives in her mind that is tormenting her. And the main directive is to kill Luke Skywalker. So essentially she's struggling with the dark side. So that's her whole story arc that she's going through right now. So Mara senses the danger and they escape. And the Force returns to her because when they were on the planet, Meeker, all the Salamari that were there suppressed her Force capabilities, but now it's returned to her, and it's slowly returning to her gradually as our story continues. And now it is revealed in our story here that Grand Admiral Thrawn had a hand in Admiral Akbar's arrest, and he had a hand in setting him up for this conspiracy, which is that there were some odd and really peculiar bank transfers that were transferred to a certain account, and basically this paper trail was linking Admiral Akbar to some kind of corruption, and this was apparently set up by Grand Admiral Thrawn. And it must be noted here that there is a mole or a spy known as Delta Source that is feeding the Empire and Grand Admiral Thrawn all this important information that is going down in the New Republic. So that's an important plot detail that we got to address right now. And at this point in the story, Jorah Seeboth is still obsessed with capturing Luke, Leia, and the twins and making them his Jedi slaves. He is essentially a madman right now, and he really, really, really wants to get Luke, Leia, and the twins in order to teach them as his apprentice, whether it's by submission or enslavement. He doesn't really care. He just wants the Jedi under his rule. So that's his main goal right now. And he is apparently chilling at a castle on Jamark. And Thrawn wants to double-cross Joris. So there's this little struggle for power between Grand Admiral Thrawn and Jorah Seeboth that is prevalent in this story, and it's very interesting. I like seeing these two struggle as far as who is going to be the one that is going to eventually rule this new empire if they succeed. So this is a very, very important plot dynamic that's going down in our story, and I really enjoy seeing the squabbling between Jorah Seeboth and Grand Admiral Thrawn, because Thrawn is a cold, calculated, intellectual character, whereas Joris is more impulsive. So it's very, very interesting to see the drama that unfolds between the two. Very entertaining stuff here. So Luke, at this point in our story, is trying to get his X-Wing repaired, but it's not going to happen because there's a lack of urgency in regards to fixing his ship over all the ships that were damaged at the Slothan shipyards, which occurred in the battle in the previous story. So Luke and Lando then hook up, since Luke can't get his ship fixed. Luke goes to check on Lando, and Lando and Luke discover a seedy character named Niles Ferrier who has infiltrated their base. And Niles Ferrier and his crew attack when Lando and Luke attempt to see what Niles is up to. And one cool thing that happens here is that Niles Ferrier uses this alien that is essentially like a wraith, and he is able to turn into shadow. But Luke is able to subdue him, and Niles tells Lando and Luke that the reason why he was there is because he was attempting to steal ships in order to get money for the Empire. Because right now, the Empire is trying to regain its power over the New Republic that it lost at the Battle of Endor, and essentially with the death of the Emperor and Darth Vader. So a lot of resources are very important to this story right now, and the Empire, Grand Admiral Thrawn, is trying to get his hand on as many ships as possible in order to stage his attack against the New Republic. Lando and Luke let Niles go if he gives them the slicer codes to bump Luke's X-Wing to the top of the priority list. So They let Niles go and they give him a warning, and they use some of that information in order to add to their intelligence and to implement maneuvers in order to prevent Thrawn from getting more ships in order to attack the New Republic. Now on Coruscant, Leia and Han meet with Mon Mothma and the other counselors in order to investigate the Sluspan battle. On the day of the Sluspan battle, it turns out bank accounts were hacked and robbed, and the money trail led to Admiral Ackbar. And here, we can totally see there's this one character named Fela, and he's a Bothan, and he is a complete and utter asshole. And you can totally tell that he has something against Admiral Ackbar, and he's trying to use, or rather exploit, this scandal in order to get him ahead in the race, in order for him to garner more power. And essentially, he wants to take Admiral Ackbar's place. So he's using this unfortunate situation in order to maneuver politically and gain more power at the expense of Admiral Ackbar. And Fela is just one of those characters you love to hate because he's so well written and he's so arrogant. And I commend Timothy Zahn for his writing and his characterization of Fela. He does a very good job. So at this council meeting, the counselors, Mon Mothma and Leia, discuss what went down at the Sluspan battle. And they emphasize a lot on the fact that Ackbar was the one that ordered the ships to Sluspan. And no one believes Han about him saying that he had proof that there was a new Grand Admiral working in the Empire. And no one wants to believe him, even though he saw and heard Thrawn. So no one wants to believe him. They dismiss him. And it's a very frustrating scene in this book because, you know, our heroes are going through so much. And we as the audience or as the readers are going through this with them. And their superiors don't want to believe him. And it's just very maddening. And again, this is just another illustration that Timothy Zahn is just a great writer because he really, really, really makes you feel the heroes in this book. And I really enjoy it. So the rumors have circulated, which were laid down by Thrawn, that a new Jedi Master exists somewhere out there. And Luke decides to investigate on Jorce Seeboth. And he learns that he was an advisor to Palpatine and that he disappeared mysteriously on Outbound Flight. And I just want to talk a little bit about Outbound Flight. And basically, it was like an expedition mission that about, I guess, I want to say 15 and 20 Jedi took part in order to investigate the unknown regions. And some things happened when there that were very mysterious and intriguing. And Timothy Zahn actually wrote a book about Outbound Flight, and I highly recommend it. It's essentially a prequel to this story, and it's all about Jorce Seeboth, and it also has Anakin Skywalker in there, and Obi-Wan Kenobi, and Grand Admiral Thrawn, and it is an outstanding prequel to the Thrawn trilogy, and I highly recommend it. So if you want to know more about this mysterious Outbound Flight that the original Jorce Seeboth partook in, check that book out. It's outstanding. And one day I'm going to do a review on that book as well. But as we move on with our current story, Han and Luke go to New Cove to investigate a possible lead on the Ackbar accusation. And the reason why Han and Luke go to New Cove is because during the war, the Bothans attacked the Victory-class Star Destroyer when they were supposed to be neutral for the most part during the rebellion. So Han finds this particularly mysterious, and also because he's seen Fela be an asshole and be an opportunist in regards to exploiting this unfortunate situation that happened to Ackbar in order to have more power politically. So he immediately begins to suspect Fela as being responsible for whatever's going on with Ackbar. So they decide to go to New Cove. Now when it comes to Leia and Chewie, they decide to go meet the Nogri, as she promised in the prior book. Now, if you don't remember, the Nogri were sent by Admiral Thrawn in order to kidnap Leia and her twins, because Thrawn and Seaboth want Leia and her Jedi twins in order for Seaboth to train them. Now, she discovered that the Nogri revere her because she is the daughter of Darth Vader. So this creates some kind of intrigue in regards to Leia and wanting to know why the Nogri really, really, really honor her for being Darth Vader's daughter, yet they are being sent to kidnap her. So she's going there to essentially investigate. And in regards to Talon Card, Talon tells Mara about the Katana Fleet, which is also known as the Dark Force. Now, what is the Katana Fleet? Now, the Katana Fleet, aka the Dark Force, are dreadnought ships, which were lost 10 years before the Clone Wars. And another interesting thing about these ships is that they use slave circuits in order to command a ship. So you were able to operate and command these dreadnought ships with less personnel. And Thrawn and Talon reveals that the crew that originally manned these ships got infected with a Hive virus and jumped to light speed at an unknown location somewhere and disappeared ever since. Talon then reveals to Mara that he came across the dreadnoughts when a deal went sour and he and his crew tried to escape via hyperspace. Now, he memorized the coordinates, but this happened 15 years ago, so right now, Talon Card has the location in his mind of these highly prized ships that the Empire are trying to get their hands on. Mara suggests selling the coordinates to the Imperials in exchange for them to get off their backs since they're being hunted by Grand Admiral Thrawn. However, Talon wants to stay neutral and he says no way because he believes that the New Republic will eventually win the war. And he believes this despite the fact that there are many bounty hunters in the galaxy that are after them because Thrawn has put out a reward for their capture. And it must be noted at this point in our story that Deltasaurus, that spy or that mole that is feeding information to Thrawn directly, has provided Thrawn with the knowledge that Han and Luke are going to New Cove. However, Thrawn just takes that information and stores it because he decides to go to the Nogri home planet first and foremost. But he doesn't know that Leia is going there in order to meet the Nogri that she set free in the prior book. So we have some suspense building right here, because Thrawn is going to Leia's location and she doesn't know that Thrawn is on his way. Now, at New Cove, Han and Lando see an aide to Fela, and they immediately suspect that something scandalous is going on, and Han follows him. But Han gets caught up by a woman following him, and she decides to capture him momentarily. Now, while this is going on, Luke and Lando are settling a bar dispute at New Cove, and it just so happens that Niles Ferrier is present, which is very suspicious. Now, back over at Han's situation, Fela's aide says that he's not really Han Solo, but a spy, and orders the woman that captured him to kill Han immediately. Now, the woman, who is known as Irenes, doesn't believe Fela's aide, because she knows that this is truly Han Solo. And it starts to look very suspicious that Fela's aide wants to kill Han Solo without any kind of thorough investigation, because he's so adamant about killing Han that it does look suspicious. So this woman, Irenes, decides to help Luke and Han escape. And now when they escape to something very, very, very surprising. They escape to a dreadnought. And this is going to have some very, very, very important ramifications later in our story. So Luke goes to Jamark to find Joris at this point. And Han and Lando go to meet Irenes' leader and try to investigate what's going on with this dreadnought. Now, Leia, on the other side of the galaxy, meets the Nogri. And she learns that the Nogri, their planet, was devastated by the war. And Grand Admiral Thrawn comes into Kamara and they have to hide Leia. Thrawn suspects something suspicious is going on because he recognizes the identification of the Nogri on that ship. Leia goes to meet a specific Nogri soldier who is the one that she decides to go back home in order to meet up with her in this book. Now, this Nogri soldier was initially sent to kidnap Leia. And this is where Thrawn's suspicions kick in because he wants to know what happened to this dude. He essentially disappeared for like a month or two and never reported back to Thrawn as being the sole survivor of the kidnapping campaign. So this is very mysterious to Thrawn, and he immediately suspects that some kind of treachery is going down here. Now, after the Nogri hide Leia, Thrawn asks, why is this soldier the only survivor, and why did he not come home immediately after his failure? Why the 2-month gap? He then assigns a droid to spy on the Nogri. Now, on the other side of the galaxy, Han discovers that the person that is commanding this mysterious dreadnought is Senator Bell Iblis, who is a senator that was long thought dead a long time ago, but he's still alive and he's working with Irenaeus almost as a separate faction of rebels in order to fight against the Empire. Now, Thrawn knows that a dreadnought picked up Han, and he discovers Wookiee hairs on that Nogri ship, indicating that that one Nogri soldier that met up with Leia is lying. So Thrawn goes to question him personally. He also hires Niles Ferrier to steal the dreadnoughts for his new empire. Now, the Nogri explain to Leia how the war destroyed their land. There's no more agriculture on their planet, and that Vader was the only person that came to aid them, and now they feel forever in the debt of the Empire. Thrawn then arrests the Nogri Kabarak for interrogation. Now, Kabarak is the one that Leia set free and showed great reverence to Leia once he found out that she was the daughter of Darth Vader. Now, at the other side of the galaxy at Jamark, Luke finally meets up with Jorah Seeboth. And I just want to say something about these little sequences in this book. The sequences with Luke and Jorah are the best parts of this book, in my opinion. They are fascinating. It's almost like watching the complete opposite of the Yoda and Luke scenes in The Empire Strikes Back. Because whereas Yoda was teaching Luke the light side of the Force to use it unselfishly and whatnot, Jorah is teaching Luke the dark side of the Force. And it's very interesting. And one main criticism of this book is that there's not enough Jorah Seeboth in this book. And there's not enough sequences between Luke and Jorah. I mean, they're my favorite scenes, but they are so short that it's kind of a letdown. And I feel like in this book, there's way too much attention being paid to Talon Card. And that is one of the main reasons why I feel like the previous book, Here to the Empire, is infinitely better than this sequel. Not that this book is bad by any means. Please don't misunderstand me. I just feel like the first book flowed a lot better and was much more exciting and was just more of a page turner. Whereas in this book, I feel myself getting anxious. Like I want to get to certain parts at the expense of other parts, and mainly at expense of all the sequences with Talon Card. I feel like Timothy Zahn wanted to keep Talon as a main character in the last two books of this trilogy, but he couldn't really find anything important for him to do, and it really kind of drags the story down. And I much would have rather preferred more pages dedicated to Jorah and Luke than Talon Card and his little band of smugglers, because it's kind of similar to Dash Rendar in Shadows of the Empire. Dash and Talon Card feel too much like Han Solo, like a Han Solo ripoff. So I like Talon Card in small intervals, which was how he was presented in the Here to the Empire book. But here he gets a lot more emphasized on, and his sequences just aren't that interesting to me. Not that they're dreadful and boring, but
again, it's like I said, I want to get back to other scenes. I want to get back to Leia and Inogri. I want to get back to Luke and Joris. Now, back to the sequences with Joris and Luke. When Luke meets up with Joris Seeboth, he can immediately see that Joris is emotionally unstable, narcissistic, and cynical. And Luke kind of feels a little uncomfortable around him, but he decides to go under his apprenticeship anyway. So Joris frequently interrupts Luke, and his nature seems rooted in the dark side. There's one sequence where Joris settles a dispute ruthlessly and violently when the party that was deemed at fault tried to kill the other. If you contrast this with Luke's version of justice, Luke issued justice and he tried to do it fairly. But Joris comes along and he's reprimanding Luke for his, I guess you want to say, for his calm and calculated and thoughtful approach to the two parties that were in this dispute. And Joris just feels like he's wasting too much time. He shouldn't try to hear anything that they have to say. Joris is like, why don't you just read their minds and get it over with? Because what happens is there's a dispute over some kind of like cattle that went over a fence. And was the fence broken? And was it the responsibility of the person that owned the fence for the cattle coming over and eating the other person's crops? And Luke is like, well, I'll look at the fence tomorrow. And Joris Seeboth is basically like, dude, why don't you just read their minds? And Luke is like, well, I feel like invading somebody's privacy like that, somebody's own personal thoughts like that is wrong. That's not something a Jedi would do. And Joris kind of scoffs at him and kind of reprimands him and scolds him for being young and naive. So there's very, very interesting dynamics going on during these exchanges between Luke and Joris. And essentially, this leads to Luke just not liking the guy. Luke doesn't like Joris. And he felt that there was a better way than reading somebody's mind. But Joris says that Jedi are above lesser beings. And you know, Luke does not look at other people like that. Luke does not look at himself as higher than other beings in the galaxy. But when they were trying to settle this dispute, one of the parties that judgment was passed upon got upset and tried to get a little violent, and Joris immediately just attacks him with some force lightning. And Luke really does not like the sight of that because he understands how painful that feels from back when he was electrocuted by the Emperor. So he doesn't like that, and he doesn't feel a Jedi should act violently like that. But Joris says that pain is the best teacher, and that this person will remember the pain and will therefore remember never to question a Jedi. Luke then thinks that Joris is basically insane and out of his mind, and Luke wants to help him, which just clearly just shows Luke's character. Luke is a loving person. He's a hopeful person. And rather than trying to take Joris out or to condemn him, Luke wants to help him. And I find it very touching. And, you know, compare that with the bullshit that was in The Last Jedi where Luke tries to kill his nephew over a vision. I mean, it's just stupid, man. Luke is a character that represents hope. And this is another example. Luke wants to help Joris, and I think it's a beautiful thing. Now, as this is going on in our story, Senator Bail Eblis tells Han Solo that the reason why Fela has such a disposition is because he does not trust Mon Mothma. And the reason why he doesn't trust Mon Mothma is because he feels that she wields too much power. Lando thinks that the senator is an Imperial agent and that the senator's dreadnoughts are the Lost Katana fleet, aka the Dark Force. So Han and Lando decide to investigate. And another thing that must be noted is that as we get to know this mysterious senator that's been out of the loop of the conflict between the rebels and the Imperials, that Senator Bell Ivelisse used to be a big contributor and a big influence on the New Republic and the political side of the rebellion. Now, another thing that must be noted is that this senator, Senator Bell Ivelisse, used to be a major, major part of the rebellion back when the rebels were fighting against the Emperor and Darth Vader. But Senator Bell Ivelisse decided to part ways with the rebellion because he too felt that Mon Mothma was wielding too much power. So there's like this little inner conflict between Mon Mothma and Senator Bell Ivelisse, and that's the reason why Bell Ivelisse went and started his own version of the rebellion. Now, as Han and Lando go investigate, Ira Ness informs Han that Bell Ivelisse started the rebellion but backed out again because Mon Mothma was getting way too powerful. And right now, Senator Bell Ivelisse is waiting to see if she will become a dictator. A dictator of the New Rebellion. She also asks Han if he could ask the New Republic Council if Senator Bell Ivelisse can return. She also reveals that Fela wants the Katana fleet for himself in order to gain more political power because it will look good if he was the one that brought back the fleet and not Bell Ivelisse. So, again, here we are being illuminated at Fela's treachery, his self-interest, and again, Fela is just an all-around asshole. Ira Ness also says that the rest of the Dreadnoughts are somewhere, and only one man at a special casino at Pantalomen knows where the Dreadnoughts are. Now, this major plot point in this story is one of the major reasons why I feel that this book is inferior to Here to the Empire and even Last Command, which is the book that follows this one. And as I stated previously, I have issues with all this emphasis on Talon Card and not enough emphasis on plot points, which I feel are much more significant. Now, when it comes to this guy at this casino planet that has this special knowledge of where the Dreadnoughts are. Now, as our story continues, we never even get to meet this guy. Essentially, this guy, he becomes sort of like a MacGuffin. Basically, what a MacGuffin is, a MacGuffin is like the thing or the person that all the characters are going after because this person either knows something or this object is important to the overall story. So this person, you know, you think you're going to get to meet him and you're going to get to know his backstory and that this person with this vast knowledge of where these mysterious Dreadnought ships are located is going to be important. But as we conclude the book, I mean, this guy, I don't even think he has one line of dialogue in the entire book. And he basically is just, I don't know, I just felt like it was poorly written, this specific part of the book, because we set it up so that this guy has this knowledge, you know, and our heroes are after this guy, right? The Imperials, they're after this guy, right? We never meet him. We never get to know about him. And it's just really weird. It's like almost like if we're going to treat this person like this, then why even make it so that a person has the knowledge of where the Katana fleet is? Why not just make it like a data disk or something? Because I was waiting to meet this person, to meet this character that has this knowledge of where the ships are and how he got that knowledge and, you know, just something, you know, I wanted to know this character and we never get to know him. We're never introduced to him. He's spoken about almost like his whole character happens off screen. So eventually the Imperials get the guy, you know, but it's like this. This is the way it's written. It's like the Imperials got the guy. We got the knowledge and then that's it. You know, you never actually have actual scenes where we see Thrawn meet this person and he says, give me the coordinates. This is the deal. The person gives it to him. None of that. There's none of that. This person that has the knowledge of where the Katana fleet is basically spoken in third person throughout the entire story. You never meet him. You never hear one line of dialogue. I think maybe they may have gone into the little backstory as to why this person knows where the Katana fleet is, but I don't remember for the life of me. And to me, that says more about the book than it does about my memory. Because I can remember a lot of details about this book. Not only did I read the actual novel, but I read the graphic novel too, and it's the same thing. And I really feel like Timothy Zahn wasn't as focused as he was when he wrote this book as he was when he wrote Here to the Empire and Last Command. And this is one of the main reasons why I gotta knock it down in comparison to the other two books in this saga. So yeah, there's this dude at this casino planet called Pantalomen, and he knows where the dreadnoughts are, and Han and Lando go to check it out. Now, while this is going on, Grand Admiral Thrawn thinks that Leia is at Endor, because the Millennium Falcon is orbiting Endor, and she's not on the ship. So the Chimera decides to take the ship. Now the Millennium Falcon is on the Chimera, so we want to know, as a reader and as the audience, how our heroes are going to get the Millennium Falcon back. He believes that the rebels are looking for the Mount Tantus storehouse. Now, this is based upon Delta Source, the spy that Thrawn has on Coruscant. So, the Imperials capture Mara. And when they capture Mara, she introduces herself as the Emperor's Hand. And this immediately creates intrigue for Grand Admiral Thrawn, because he wants to know what happened to her and where she's been and what she's been up to since the fall of the Emperor and Darth Vader, since the loss at Endor. So, she offers Thrawn the location of the Katana fleet in exchange for stopping the bounty on Talon Card and his band of smugglers. Now, Thrawn agrees, but he tells her that she wasn't the only Emperor's Hand that the Emperor had on command. And this kind of shakes Mara up, because she thought she was special. She thought she was the only Emperor's Hand. She thought she was the only assassin, you know, at the disposal of the Emperor. And this kind of shakes her up and shakes her reality. So it's interesting. And now another thing must be noted when it comes to Grand Admiral Thrawn's genius is that he knows that Senator Bell Iblis's dreadnoughts are part of the Katana fleet. And he assigns Nals Ferrier to go after Han and to go to that casino planet in order to extract the two possible sources of the fleet. So Admiral Thrawn is one step ahead of our heroes in obtaining the Katana fleet, aka Dark Force Rising. Now, back across the galaxy at the Nokree home planet, Leia decides to escape with Kabarak, who was the Nokree soldier that brought her to their home planet. Han then gets a questionable message from Luke to meet at New Cove, but it turns out that it was not Luke Skywalker, it was Nals Ferrier. When Han finds this out, he's kind of upset because he thought he was meeting Luke Skywalker, but instead he met up with Nals Ferrier, a pirate and smuggler that Han knows not to trust. So the reason why Niles wanted to meet up with Han Solo is because he wanted to offer the ID on the person who knows where the Katana fleet is located. Han decides not to believe Ferrier and turns down the offer. But Niles, instead of being disgruntled and feeling like Han dissed him, he decides to put a tracking beacon on the ship. Now, Han doesn't believe Niles Ferrier. He knows that he's full of shit. So he turns down the offer. But Niles puts a tracking beacon on Han's ship in order to follow him. Now, Mara is betrayed by Thrawn at this point in our story, and he abducts Talon when they meet up. And this makes Mara Jade furious at Thrawn, and she tries to force choke Thrawn, but Thrawn doesn't even flinch. He has his Salamari with him, and Mara is powerless. Thrawn then offers her command of a dreadnought and promises he will give Talon money and take away the bounty if he says where the Katana fleet is. She reluctantly agrees, but her real plan is to go to Luke and ask him for help. So she decides to go where Luke is located, which is the planet Jomark. Because you got to remember, at this point in our story, Luke is training with Joris on Jomark. And the reason why she knows that Luke is at Jomark, because she was able to hack into an Imperial computer and know and learn the location of Joris. Now back on Jomark, where Luke is training with Joris Seaboth, again, Luke is seeing that Joris is mentally unstable. He perceives others as lesser beings who hate and fear the Jedi, and that Joris feels like the Jedi should be rulers of lesser beings, and he doesn't feel right about it. He knows something's wrong. He can sense the dark side. Now, when Mara goes to Jomark to meet up with Luke, she's immediately attacked by Joris Seaboth with these flying boulders and rocks against her ship. Now, she's smart and she decides to bring some Salamari with her. And when her ship crashes on the planet Jomark, Joris goes to her and tries to convince her to join him in order to train under him and to be another one of his apprentices. But Luke catches Joris attacking Mara and disagrees with his tactics and disagrees with his whole approach to training. And he reminds Joris that the Jedi never attack. They never use the Force for attack, only for defense. Joris then tells Mara that she will bow to him one day. And Joris attacks Luke with lightning. But he uses his lightsaber to block the lightning. And R2 decides to use the X-Wing cannons to knock Joris out. Luke refuses to kill Joris because, again, a Jedi does not kill. A Jedi does not attack. A Jedi only uses the Force for defense. Mara insists that you kill him to get it over with. He's a bad guy. He's an enemy. But Luke thinks that he can save Joris just like his father. Again, Luke feels he can save Joris just like his father. You hear that, Rian Johnson? You fucking idiot. The guy that made Last Jedi? You're stupid. Luke feels that he can save people. Ugh, I'll never let that go. So whatever, moving on in our story. They leave Jomark to go save Talon. And Mara tells Luke that Vader lost his right hand for failing at Yavin during that Death Star battle. So right there, this is just an important plot point that I want to point out and talk about. And as you can tell, this is contradictory to what was set down in the movies. Because in the movies, it was Count Dooku that cut off Anakin's right hand. And here, obviously, this book was written before the prequel trilogy. This is the Bantam era. And so we didn't have the prequels out. So that wasn't canon. It wasn't canon that Count Dooku cut off Anakin's right hand. So when this book came out, it was the Emperor that cut off Darth Vader's right hand for his failure in the Death Star trench battle. I prefer the prequel version a lot more, just because I like to think that Vader was already mechanical when he had the suit on. I don't like to think that he became more of a machine after he had the suit on. It kind of doesn't make sense for me. But again, it's just an interesting historical fact of what was going down prior to when the prequels were released. So Mara and Luke go and sneak upon the Chimera. And the way that they were able to sneak upon the Chimera, because Thrawn is under the presumption that Mara has agreed to work with the Empire. But Mara and Luke rescue Talon, and Thrawn gets alerted to this. But they decide to escape on the Millennium Falcon, which was on board the Chimera when they found it orbiting the planet Endor. So they escape on the Falcon. And Talon offers the Katana fleet to the New Republic, which is very surprising. While this is going down, Grand Admiral Thrawn knows who has the fleet. And the reason why he knows is because he knows through Niles Ferrier. Because Niles followed Han and Lando to that casino planet where they were going to meet up with that person that we never meet, that knew where the location of the Katana fleet was. So again, I kind of don't like the way this part of the story was written, because we never meet or never even hear from this supposed person that has this knowledge where the Katana fleet is, and I kind of felt like it wasn't very well thought out. But the rest of the story is very well written. Now, moving on. Leia discovers that the Nogri have been in servitude for the Empire for 44 years, and this makes her furious, because she feels that their debt should have been way paid for by now. Their debt to the Empire should have been repaid, and their land should have been flourishing by now. If their land was devastated by the war that took place 44 years ago, then it wasn't the rebellion that destroyed their planet. So it was during the Clone Wars that their planet was destroyed. And 44 years should be more than enough time for their planet to be able to have agriculture again. So Leia immediately suspects that something treacherous is going down. And she eventually finds out that the Empire is not helping the Nogri. They are in fact poisoning their land, because what they were doing is that they were supposed to be expediting droids to work upon the land. And what they would do is that they would like try to inject some kind of, I guess you want to say, substance that's supposed to make the natural vegetation of the planet regrow. But instead, this same weed, this particular weed, was the only plant that would grow on this planet. And the Nogri felt that the reason why was because the crashes and the battles that took place changed the nature of the land, and that only that particular plant was able to grow from then on. So it actually turns out that those droids were poisoning the land in order to keep the Nogri people enslaved. And Leia finds this out, and she decides to meet with their clan dynast in order to explain this to them. And there's a really cool scene, because the dynast knows that Grand Admiral Thrawn wants Leia, so they feel like she's a criminal and they're going to capture her. They don't want to listen to her. They just want to call Thrawn up immediately and report that they have Leia. But she insists that they are being tricked. And the only way that she was able to get the Nogri to listen to her was by performing an impossible feat using the Force. And what she does is she ignites her lightsaber and she lets it float in front of them by using the Force. And I thought it was a real cool scene and another great way to show that Leia has the Force and that she's slowly becoming a Jedi. And this is another reason why I love these books. I love seeing Leia's growth in the Force and her taking these small steps to eventually becoming a Jedi one day. After she finishes this performance, they believe her, and they say they will consider joining the New Republic in their fight against the Empire. Now, on the other side of the galaxy, at that casino planet, Niles Ferrier abducts the dude that knows where the Katana fleet is, and he's able to get to this guy before Han and Lando could find him. And again, and then that's it. You never meet the guy that knows where the Katana fleet is. You never talk to him. You never hear a single word or line of dialogue come out of his mouth. And again, instead of having this guy that we never meet have the knowledge of where the Katana fleet is, I think it would have been much better to put it on a data disk or something. I just see no reason to put the knowledge inside of a character that we never meet. I just think it was stupid. Now, back on the other side of the galaxy at Coruscant, Fela is still being an asshole. He doesn't believe Han that the guy got away, and he doesn't believe that Talon Card truly knows where the Katana fleet is. Instead, he wants to send a reconnaissance team to investigate the coordinates first. Talon then says, okay, but I will give you the coordinates tomorrow, not now and not today. Han then confronts Fela about this aid that he was supposedly following on that one planet at New Cove, but Fela denies it all. Talon then sends Mara Jade to the Katana fleet first and tells Leia privately the coordinates of where the Katana fleet is so she can get there before Fela's reconnaissance team. Card also wants his personal hacker to investigate the Ackbar scandal regarding the mysterious bank accounts and the paper trail that was led to them. Once Fela finds out that Leia had the knowledge of where the Katana fleet was, and that Leia sent Han and Luke to investigate before his reconnaissance team, Fela demands that Luke and Han are arrested, which is outrageous because these are our heroes. These are the heroes of the rebellion. And Fela is demanding that they are arrested. And again, Fela is a great villain. He frustrates the hell out of me, but in a good way. So now what happens next? Fela and his reconnaissance team go with Talon, Card, and Leia after the Katana fleet. Luke and Han find the Katana fleet, but the Imperials arrive right when they get there. And there's this huge and impressive battle that takes place. Now, when Fela gets there and he discovers that there's a battle taking place, Fela becomes a huge coward. And even though he ordered their arrest, he wants to abandon them. Now, Leia is outraged by this and she is furious. She cannot leave her husband and brother behind to face a certain doom. And while this is going on, Fela decides to speak negatively about the army, about the troops, and he just starts to go on this huge tirade talking about how the military are kind of like lesser beings in comparison to political officials. And while this is going on, Talon Card decides to broadcast his little speech where he dehumanizes the military out loud to all the X-Wing fighters and to all the soldiers who are partaking in this big battle over the Katana fleet. And as soon as the military and all the soldiers hear the true sentiments that Fela has, they decide to ignore him and are like, no way, there's no way we are going to abandon Han and Luke and let them fight this battle against Thrawn alone. And ultimately, they're going to let Thrawn get the Katana fleet, which is just going to empower the Imperials all the more. So they're like, no, we're going to stay and fight. Fuck you, Fela. And Fela basically gets sent back to his quarters. No one wants to hear anything he has to say. Now, while the battle's going on, Jorah Seeboth decides to appear right when Thrawn is about to join the battle. And this causes Thrawn great annoyance. And he really feels like the time has come to do something permanently about Jorah and his unexpected outbursts and his unstable emotions. So this kind of is foreshadowing how things are going to go down in the next book, The Last Command. Now, right when this battle is going on, this battle over the Katana fleet, aka the Dark Force, Senator Bail Iblis decides to show up with his dreadnoughts in order to lend some aid to Luke and Han. Luke is able to slice open the hole because while this battle is taking place, the Imperials land on one of the dreadnought ships that Han and Luke were on, and they get cornered. So you have all these troops coming, and Luke feels a disturbance in the Force because he feels that there's something off and something wrong with these troopers. And it turns out that they're clones. And this is the reason why he felt a disturbance in the Force, because there was something off about their Force, the Force that was with them. Something unnatural. And I guess you want to say something kind of like a perversion in the Force. So Luke and Han are cornered by these oncoming stormtroopers that are coming after them. And the only way that Luke is able to save the day is by slicing the hull open with his lightsaber, which sucks all the troopers out into space. Lando is able to remotely control a crash. So he's able to hack into the system of one of the dreadnoughts and remotely control one of the dreadnoughts to crash into a Star Destroyer. And I thought that was a great image. It kind of reminded me of the way that they used the hammerhead in Rogue One to crash into the Imperial Star Destroyer, which was a great scene. This was very similar to me and I really enjoyed it. So what happens next is that Luke and Han are saved, but the Katana fleet is lost to the Empire. So it was kind of a defeat in some way for our heroes. And they soon discover, after losing the Katana fleet, that Thrawn is already making clones. And yeah, like I said previously, this is why Luke was feeling a disturbance in the Force when those troopers came on board to one of the dreadnoughts to capture them. So this kind of leaves a dark foreshadowing for the events to come in the next book, The Last Command. So at this point in our story, Thrawn has the dreadnoughts, Thrawn has the Dark Force, aka the Katana fleet, and Thrawn has clones because he is using the Sparty cylinders on Mount Tantus in the Emperor's old storehouse to create clones. So he is going to have more than enough personnel to command these dreadnought ships. So things are not looking good for our heroes at this point in the story.
So in conclusion, I want to say that I enjoyed how this book ended. It kind of ended on a cliffhanger note with the clones being introduced. And if you read this book before the prequel trilogy came out, it was very exciting, you know, because we had no idea about clones being integrated in the Star Wars saga. All we had was that simple dialogue between Obi-Wan Kenobi and Luke Skywalker from A New Hope. So to see the clones be introduced at this point in the Star Wars saga, it was exciting because we knew nothing about the clones and we could get a little glimpse about the history of the Clone Wars, just a very little one. And even though it's been retconned, because in this book the clones fought against the Jedi, it was still exciting. And nevertheless, even if we retcon it to fit with the current Clone Wars, it's still an exciting read because the clones are being reintroduced and you feel that the Empire can potentially come back, especially under Grand Admiral Thrawn. So if Grand Admiral Thrawn's going to have a bunch of clones manning the dreadnought ships, you know, that's a threat to the New Republic. So it ended on an exciting cliffhanger and it really leaves you wanting to read the next novel in the book. However, those complaints that I had, the MacGuffin subplot, which was kind of felt poorly executed, and the lack of Jorah Seeboth and Luke Skywalker scenes, I wanted more. Those were so great, but there were just too few of it. You know, I wanted more scenes like that. And just the Talon Card subplot, I felt it just took too much up of that story for just a little payoff, in my opinion. I would have much rather had some of those pages dedicated to Luke. So all in all, I gotta give the sequel to Here to the Empire, Dark Force Rising, a B+. And I still recommend it. It's not a perfect book by any means, but I still highly recommend it. And I want to thank you guys for sticking with me through this review and analysis. And I wish you all well. May the Force be with you and stick around for book 3, which will be The Last Command. Take care, y'all.